You're listening to the audio production of When Mountains Move by Julie Cantrell, published by Thomas Nelson and read by Amy Rubinate.
Chapter 1. Friday, May 7th, 1943. Church bells strike to announce the hour. My body quakes from the force of the sound, and again from the force of the man, uninvited. He pushes me down, nails his elbow into my throat. I fight, kicking, clawing, screaming. Someone calls my name.
Millie?
I throw my fists into the night, lunging wide-eyed toward the voice.
Millie, stop, it's me.
Bump wraps his arms around me and I jerk back, pushing against him. He withdraws, asking,
You okay?
I don't answer. Instead, I stare at the pitch of the darkened ceiling and pull myself from the depths of the dream. Bump slides close again and touches my hand.
You always sleep in your boots?
He smiles, trying to make light of the dark. He doesn't know I've spent the last 6 weeks fully dressed, even through the night, always ready to run or to fight. I try to measure my breath, slow my pulse. It was only a dream, Millie. Calm down. Storm's got me a little edgy. I offer Bump an apologetic smile. I don't tell him how every time I'm alone, I stay on full alert. How strange sounds and shadows, and even the wind, can make me look behind and check for danger. I wasn't always this way, and I hope I can feel safe again someday soon. For now, I leave the cot in the corner of the foaling room and walk across the red dirt floors of the Coy Tucker rodeo barn, still trying to emerge from the haunting nightmare. Was I screaming? I ask Bump. I'm always fighting and screaming in the dream. If only I could have done that during the actual assault. The one that left me frozen and numb, silenced on the steeple room floor.
Nope.
Bump's footsteps follow my own.
Not a sound, just mean as a wolverine.
He smiles. Even now, weeks after the event, my dreams are the only place I have a voice. Bump tries again to cheer me.
Didn't mean to scare you.
He wraps his arms around my waist and turns me toward him, delivering a strong kiss, pumped with passion. I try to let him ease my fears, but when he moves me against the coarse wooden slats of the barn, my shoulder hits the wall a little too fast, a little too hard. I flinch. A rising panic tenses my throat. My body ebbs and flows between desire and disgust. It's not his fault, Millie. You can do this. There's no debating whether I love Bump. I do. But there is too much he doesn't know about me. I want to give him the truth right now, before we say our vows. Then maybe he could understand why he's found me frightened like this in the middle of the night. It's after midnight. I struggle to find words to start. What are you doing out here? I reach for a towel to dry him. He's walked in the rain all the way from the back barracks where he stays with the rodeo hands, a mixed bunch of cowboys stopping by between ranch jobs.
Missed you is all.
He pulls me back to him, moving his fingers from my shoulders down to my waist, then below. At 17, I should want this. And not long ago I did. But now, everything is different. Now I am afraid of what a man can do. Even one as good and kind as Bump. I pull away, gently, and hope Bump knows I don't want him to leave. I just want him to slow down. Give me time. I'm not ready. Bad luck to see me before the wedding. I smile.
No such thing.
Bump catches my ear in his mouth and whispers,
How's that cot holding up?
Oh, the cot. I run my fingers around his drenched collar beneath his stubbled chin. I don't know what I'll do without it. I try to match his playful mood. Think there'll be room to take it with us?
No room at all. In fact, I'm thinking we'd better give it a final farewell right now. Something to remember us by.
Thunder clashes, and the paint mare in the back stall releases a loud, guttural response. Two others yell back to her, and the barn is suddenly a symphony of horse talk. I tap Bump's chest with my finger and softly scold, "I think we can wait, Mr. Anderson."
"Impossible."
He brushes my dark curls behind my ear and kisses my neck, then my collarbone. Just 6 weeks ago, a kiss like this would have sent me into flame. But that was before. Before Bill Miller caused my body to react with panic every time it is touched. Bump struggles to remove my shirt in the dark, the small buttons proving difficult for his strong fingers.
"Was hoping I'd find you undressed at this hour."
One button slips through. I pull from him and move toward the hay room, flipping a light switch and drawing louder reactions from the horses. Bump stays behind and watches me walk. I glance back long enough to catch his crooked smile, the one that tugs my heart in its tender corners and makes me cling to the possibility of happy ever after. As the radio warms from a soft buzz to a heavy hum, I spin the tuner. Between cracks of static, the final few notes of an unfamiliar song seep out from the speakers. Then, a pause before Harry and Trudy Babbitt give voice to the Kay Kaiser hit from last year. "Who wouldn't love you?" they sing. "Who wouldn't care?" With a flick of my wrist, I toss Bump a pair of leather gloves. He catches them without looking, both in one hand.
"Getting cold feet?"
Worry lines his voice. "Not a chance." I try to sound positive as I haul hay to the row of stalls. "I just figure we might as well get a jump on the morning jobs. We've already got the horses all confused." Bump follows with some old winter carrots, giving one wrinkled stalk to each horse. "How about you?" I ask. "You ready to back out?"
"You kidding, Millie? I would have married you the first day I saw you."
Outside, the moon has sunk behind swollen clouds, and the stars have been swallowed by storm. In here, the fan blades spin as the bright bulbs buzz like strange mouse shouting from the heavens. "Tell him, Millie," they yell. "Tell him the truth." Bugs swarm the lights as if even they want to stop all the noise. I take a carrot from Bump and move back to offer an extra one to my favorite horse, Firefly. She takes it in three bites while I pet her soft bay coat. "I miss you, sweet girl." I trace the white blaze that lines the bridge of her nose. "But you'll be joining us in Colorado soon, I promise." She knickers. I hope she understands. Bump runs his fingers along my spine, then pulls me to him again. I try to let the truth surface, but no matter how much I want to tell him everything that's happened, the deep black force of fear gets in the way. Between Bump's repeated attempts to take me to the cot and my stubborn resistance, we spend the hours filling feed bins and topping water pails, grooming the mares and mucking the stalls. By the time we cross the final job from our daily list, the rain stops and the sun creeps in. We're just cleaning up the last of the brushes when a wave of nausea slams me, one of many I've dealt with in recent days. I bolt for the door and Bump follows me, concerned.
"You all right?"
He moves closer, speaks softly. I bend behind the pines and try not to let him see me get sick. With all that's happened in the last year, it's no wonder my gut is a wreck. But life is better now. Much better. I hope this is the last time I ever let worry get the best of me. "I'm okay." I wipe my mouth with the back of my shirt sleeve, mortified. "Nerves, I guess."
"Nerves?" Bump seems stung. "Thought you weren't getting cold feet."
"Not about the marrying part." It's not a complete lie. But yes, to be honest, I am a little nervous about the rest of it.
"What rest of it?"
My voice grows quiet. It's the old Millie coming through again. Yella, weak. The truth is, I'm not sure I deserve Bump, and I wonder if others are thinking the same thing. What I mean is, your entire family is coming. I have to stand up there in front of everyone we know and...
And what?
Bump's jaw sets, his shoulders stiffen. And I look away. Pretend I'm good enough for you. I step around a mud puddle and make my way back into the barn, hoping the smells don't get to me again. Bump tromps right through the puddle.
Good enough? For me? Millie, the guys can't believe I ever got you to talk to me, much less marry me. I still keep expecting you to make a run for it.
Then he adds,
please don't.
There's a sound in Bump's voice I've never heard. Doubt. I give him my full attention again and exhale. Bump's blue eyes hold my own as he waits for my answer. That same color that first reminded me of hydrangea blooms. I won't if you won't, I say. And suddenly I mean it. No matter how unsure I've been feeling, a promise is a promise. And it's one I want to keep. I move closer, rest my head against his sturdy chest, and allow myself to find safety in his long, lean frame. Bump lets the music move us while Sinatra croons. A peaceful sky, there are such things. A rainbow high where heaven sings. So have a little faith and trust in what tomorrow brings. Chapter 2. There's something romantically hopeful about having a wedding in the middle of a war. Janine is speaking before she enters the barn. I've known her for 6 months now, and she's been talking ever since. When she turns the corner and spots Bump with me, her pitch jumps 2 octaves. What in heaven's name are you doing here, Bump? Janine swoops her arms in big circles and begins to shoo. It's bad luck. Get. She gives Bump a frisky nudge, but he manages to plant one last kiss on my cheek before darting for safety. If I catch you back in here again before the ceremony, you'll be sorry. Janine's chirp is less painful to me now than when I first met the Spitfire secretary, but I still pinch my ears when she hits certain notes. He just can't wait, can he? Janine giggles, and her entire frame, barely 5 feet high, springs with glee. I swat at Janine, laughing. We head out to the pasture as a bicycle bell dings from behind us. Sis! Sis! Camille's called me this for months. Since the day her mother, Diana, took mercy on me and brought me home to live with them. Camille greeted me that day with an enthusiastic hug and announced she'd always wanted a sister, as if Diana had just brought home a stray puppy from behind the corner store. Camille drops her bike onto the wet grass before bouncing her way toward us, making Janine laugh. Morning, Camille, I say, lifting my hand to block the sun from my eyes. For the record, I no longer answer to Camille. Call me Anne. She lifts her cotton dress and curtsies. Camille always acts years beyond her age. She's only 10. Anne? Janine feeds Camille the attention she craves. Oh, please do tell me why Anne. After Anne Sheridan, of course. Didn't you see her on the cover of Motion Picture Hollywood magazine? Mabel thinks I look just like her. Camille tilts her chin up and to the right, striking a pose, then spins in circles, making her light pink dress flare. For the moment, every bit of anxiety breaks away, and I want to keep feeling like this, hopeful, believing I really can forget the past and that everything is going to be okay. Janine and I lean against a magnolia tree and watch Camille spin herself dizzy. How did Diana Miller end up with such a sweet kid? Janine whispers under a smile. Thank goodness Camille doesn't hear. Diana's not as bad as she seems. I shrug. Janine rolls her eyes. If you say so, honey. Well, she did take me in when no one else offered. Then why in heaven's name did you move into the horse barn, Millie? Everybody thought you'd plumb lost your mind. I don't dare tell Janine the real reason I left the posh Miller home, or how even the Millers couldn't give me the only thing I ever wanted, a loving family of my own. I think back to the sudden shift in Diana after she learned that her husband...
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.